how I met Steven Spielberg. It was through his agent, Guy McElwain, who submitted a script called Ace Eli and Roger of the Skies, which I liked. And so I called up Guy and I said, look, I like this script and I want to buy it from you. He said, well, there's one condition, and that is that you have to sit down with the potential director who's under contract to Universal. Young kid, done a lot of great television. So I said, I don't have to use him, do I? And he said, no, you don't have to use him. He just wants to sit down and talk to you. So that's how Steven and I met.
The thing that really impressed me more than anything else was he actually had a conversation with me. And there had been a lot of producers up till that time that were just very happy to get me out of the office. And Richard had a wonderful conversation with me, and he was very honest with me. And he actually came out and said that he felt that I was too young and inexperienced and hoped that I would continue my involvement in the project, you know, with some writing services, but that he probably would not be hiring me to direct the movie.
This fellow, as a young person, knew more about filmmaking than any young person I'd ever met, or maybe any person I'd ever met.
He asked very, very intelligent questions of me, actually putting me into a position where I had to honestly question my own experience and whether I was really ready for a feature film. And I wasn't. I honestly can tell you right now, I wasn't then. But it was a fair meeting that we had, and I walked out of that office feeling better than I did before I walked in, even though I knew I didn't have the job. I didn't see Dick again until I had turned in the script of the Sugarland Express to Jennings Lang at Universal.
I told him I wanted to make it, I loved it and everything. He said, you know, by the way, it's on turnaround, which was parlance for the studio who developed it, was sending it out to the world to see if anybody would make it because they had decided not to make it. And I said, that's okay, I'm gonna see Lou Wasserman tomorrow for lunch, I'll bring it up. So I went up to see Lou and I said, I like the script. And he said, I do too, but nobody will go see it. So then we went on to talk about all kinds of other projects for about a half an hour. And as the meeting was over, he walked me to the door and he said, when can you start? And I said, he caught me off guard. I said, start what? And he said, the Sugarland Express. And I said, well, I thought you said it played empty theaters. He said, Dick, I wouldn't have made this deal with you if I thought I knew more about picture making. He said, that's why I made the deal with you. Go ahead and make the picture.
Sugarland was my first feature, so everything about it was difficult. Everything about it was new. But, you know, Dick was really a fantastic support system for me. All he basically did was to show up and be there all the time, every day, on the set, in meetings. He was always there. He never interrupted me when I was speaking. He never overruled me on an idea that he thought was better than an idea that I was putting out there. All he did was back up my ideas and say, yeah, that's a great idea, let's do that. I had never been supported that way in my life.
Every director wants him as their producer because every director believes that he only cares about what they, the director, want. And that's true. He's there to protect their vision. But at the same time, every studio executive loves Dick because we think that he's there to protect our interests and to bring the budget in on time and to make the best possible movie. So this unique balancing act between satisfying both ends of the filmmaking process, I think is so difficult and so much Dick Zanuck's unique talent.
David was the master at getting early looks at material. We saw Jaws. David sent me a copy, and we both stayed up all night reading it and talked as we did first thing every morning. We both couldn't figure out how could we do it, but that became secondary. The first thing, let's buy it and figure out how to do it later. And so Stephen happened to see the galleys on my assistant's desk.
And I just remember asking if I could read the book. I'm a slow reader, I've always been a very slow reader, but I got through the book in about 2.5 days, which is fast for me. And I went back to Dick and David and I said, I know how to make this into a film. But the book had already been offered to another director who was scheduled to meet with Peter Benchley, the author.
We set up a meeting, met this director, but the lunch went very poorly. And this was the lunch that we were trying to convince Benchley that this guy was our director.
And they said, well, we had the meeting with the other director, but the other director kept referring to the shark as the whale. And Peter became very disinterested in having his shark called a whale.
And so we brought Stephen on, and I went up to Wasserman's office and said, we want the kid to direct this picture. And he said, Dick, you need a more seasoned director. And I said, Lou, with all due respect, that's exactly what we don't want. I want to see this picture through the kid's eyes.
He's kind of characteristic of that, you know, never retreat, never surrender. He would see a project through, you know, no matter what the obstacles were. And on Jaws, there were, you know, plenty of obstacles.
It was very, very difficult, but it led to a better picture because, for example, the barrels, that was because we had no shark. The shark was on dry dock and never working.
I had no idea, nor did anybody on the production, how difficult it was going to be to float that monstrosity and get it to work in the actual ocean. I think if we had shot the film in a tank without strong tides and without, you know, waves, I think we would have had a easier time, but the audience would have rejected the movie because it would have looked like the shark was in the lake, not in the ocean. And that's why I insisted on shooting the picture on open water in the open sea of the Atlantic. Everything on land I did on schedule. The second we got out to sea, I was getting one shot a day, sometimes no shots a day. On a good day, I get four shots in a day. And I knew we were going to be out there for months, months. And that's when Dick and David were always there, not only to reassure me and say, keep going, don't despair, you're getting good stuff. And I said, good stuff, you saw one shot in dailies. But it was a great shot, Dick would say. It was a great shot. Get more great shots like that. Tomorrow, try to get five great shots. And I said, Dick, I'll be lucky if we get a shot before lunch and a shot before the sun goes down. And he always was understanding because he saw what it was like out there. He was out there with us.